Would you please stand and join me in our call to worship? Christ Jesus bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. For us, Christ became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. Let us pray. O Christ, who betrayed no one and was betrayed by the closest of friends, and who committed no crime, yet was sentenced to a criminal's death, we enter into your presence this evening in awe and adoration. On this day, centuries ago, you could have saved your life, but you refuse to betray the purpose for which you have been born. You had come into the world to love God and neighbor as yourself. This was the love for which you had been created. And when that love required you to shoulder a cross, you summoned the strength to bear it. And so today, O Christ, as we sing and pray about your cross, teach us its meaning once again. And help us to take up our cross and follow you. Amen. Let's sing together. Please be seated. scripture reading this evening comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 10. Listen now for God's word. Very truly, I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he's brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them. They didn't understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus again said to them, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. Well, someone once asked me, do you think Jesus knew what he was doing? I thought about that question for a little bit, and I thought it was a silly question. And then I thought it might be a question about Jesus' intelligence. That wasn't it. And then I wondered if it was a question of some kind of theological navel-gazing about whether Jesus was omniscient, whether Jesus could see into the future. That wasn't it either. That's when I really began to think about my answer. And I realized that my answer to that seemingly simple question makes all the difference in the world. See, it makes all the difference in the world if Jesus' life was just a series of coincidences, some of which were unfortunate events. A series of coincidences through which God was somehow able to work out the saving of the world. And that would mean that the story of our redemption was some kind of cosmic accident. Jesus just happened to be in the right place at the right time. And then God looked down at what was happening to Jesus, saw a moment of opportunity, and said, aha, a cross, that'll do. It makes all the difference in the world if Jesus really knew what he was doing. That while it might look as though Jesus is in total control of the situation, it's just an illusion. Because see, in fact, Jesus has been in control since the beginning. Jesus has known how this was going to end since the beginning. Because this is exactly what Jesus was sent to do. In other words, none of this was an accident. This isn't a cosmic case of making lemonade out of lemons. This isn't a case of God making the best out of a really bad situation. Jesus makes sure that we know that without a shadow of doubt. He knows what he's doing. He knows what he's walking into. He knows what's going to happen. He knows how all of this is going to play out. The cross wasn't an accident. Jesus isn't the victim of unfortunate circumstances. Jesus isn't powerless in the face of injustice or mob violence, or even betrayal by those who claim to love him. Jesus knew why he had to come. He knew why he was here. Jesus knew what it was going to take. God sent his son, Jesus, into the world to live and to suffer and to die on a cross, in 3 days to be raised, so that through his son, God might save the world. Jesus knew what he was doing. And so he willingly lays down his life. He does it because he is the good shepherd. And a good shepherd will do anything to protect his sheep. A good shepherd will even put his life on the line for the sheep. And the good shepherd does it simply because he loves the sheep. If there's any comfort in Jesus' suffering and death on a cross, on a Friday, all those years ago, a Friday that, quite honestly, is not all that different from today, it's this. Jesus chooses the cross. And he does it simply because he loves us, and he'll stop at nothing. Not suffering, not beatings, cross, not even death itself, to make that love real, to save us. And Jesus knew what he was doing. And that's why this is a good Friday. Let's pray. Oh Lord, help us to believe this good news, that you willingly chose a cross, that you willingly chose to lay down your life for us. You did all of it simply because you love us. Lord, may we understand that truth. May we believe that. Change that truth. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you please stand and let's sing. Thank you. Beloved people of God, as Jesus stretched out his arms on the cross to offer life and salvation to all, let us pray for the world that God loves so much. Let us pray for the church throughout the world. Almighty and eternal God, you have shown your glory to all nations in Jesus Christ. By your Holy Spirit, guide the church and gather it throughout the world. Help it to persevere in faith, proclaim your name, and bring the good news of salvation in Christ to all people. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for this presbytery and congregation. Mighty and eternal God, your Spirit guides the church and makes it holy. Strengthen and uphold pastors, elders, deacons, and other leaders. Keep them in health and safety for the good of the church. Help each of us to do faithfully the work to which you have called us. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those preparing for baptism. Almighty and eternal God, you continue to bless the church with new members. Increase the faith and understanding of those preparing for baptism. Give them new birth as your children. Keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church. Make all the baptized one in the fullness of faith and keep us united in the fellowship of love. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those who cannot believe. Almighty and eternal God, you created humanity so that all might long to know you and find peace in you. Grant that all may recognize signs of your love and grace in the world and in the lives of Christians. We gladly acknowledge you as the one true God. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for God's creation. Almighty and eternal God, you are the creator of a magnificent universe. Hold this world in the arms of your care. Heal the damage we have done and bring all things to fulfillment in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for the leaders and people of all nations. Almighty and eternal God, you are the champion of the poor and the oppressed. In your goodness, give wisdom to those in authority so that people everywhere may enjoy justice, peace, freedom, and a share of the goodness of your creation. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for all who suffer or are in need. Almighty and eternal God, you give strength to the weary and new courage to those who have lost heart. Hear the prayers of all who call on you in any trouble, that they may have the joy of receiving your help in their need. We ask this through Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Be confessing our sins this evening using an ancient form of prayer called the Solemn Reproaches of the Cross. It is a responsive prayer. Each of the sections will end with the words, "But you have made a cross for your Savior," at which time I'll invite you to respond with holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. O my people, O my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer. I led you out of slavery into freedom and delivered you through the waters of rebirth, but you have made a cross for your sin. Forty years I led you through the desert, feeding you with manna on the way. I saved you from the time of trial and gave you my body, the bread of heaven. But you have made a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy
on us. I led you on your way in a pillar of cloud and fire, but you led me to the judgment hall of Pilate. I guided you by the light of the Holy Spirit, but you have made a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us.
I planted you as my fairest vineyard, but you brought forth bitter fruit. I made you branches of the vine and never left your side, but you have made a cross for your Savior. I poured out saving water from the rock, but you gave me vinegar to drink. I poured out my life and gave you the new covenant in my blood, but you have made a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy on us.
I gave you a royal scepter, but you gave me a crown of thorns. I gave you the kingdom and crowned you with eternal life. But you have made a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy on us.
I struck down your enemies, but you struck my head with a reed. I gave you my peace, but you draw the sword in my name. And you have made a cross for your Savior. I opened the waters to lead you to the promised land, but you opened my side with a spear. I washed your feet as a sign of my love, but you have made a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy on us.
I lifted you up to the heights, but you lifted me high on the cross. I raised you from death and prepared you for the tree of life. You have made a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy
grafted you into my people Israel, but you've made them scapegoats for your own guilt, and you've made a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us.
I was hungry, and you gave me no food. Thirsty, and you gave me no drink. A stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. But you have made a cross for your sin.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us.
Take a moment to make this prayer your own. Second scripture reading this evening comes from the Gospel of John. It consists of the chapters 18 and 19 in their entirety. After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again, he asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these people go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest, but Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it's cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "You are not also one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, I am not. One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, did I not see you in the garden with him? Again, Peter denied it. At that moment, the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, what accusation do you bring against this man? They answered, if this man were not a criminal, would we have handed him over to you? Pilate said to them, take him yourselves and judge him according to your law. The Jews replied, we are not permitted to put anyone to death. This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, are you the king of the Jews? Jesus answered, do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me? Pilate replied, I'm not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done? Jesus answered, my kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom belonged to this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here. Pilate asked him, so you are a king? Jesus answered, you say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice. Pilate asked him, what is truth? After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews? They shouted in reply, not this man, but Barabbas. Now Barabbas was a rebel. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews, and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him. So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, Behold the man. When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, Crucify him! Crucify him! Pilate said to them, Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him. The Jews answered him, We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has claimed to be the Son of God. Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, Where are you from? But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and power to crucify you? Jesus answered him, You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin. From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, If you release this man, you are no friend of Caesar. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against Caesar. When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, Here is your king. They cried out, Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him! Pilate asked them, Shall I crucify your king? The chief priests answered, We have no king but Caesar. Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but 'This man said, I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says: "They divided my clothes among themselves. For my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." And he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified, so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth, so that you also may continue to believe. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled: "None of his bones shall be broken." Again, another passage of scripture says, "They will look on the one whom they have pierced." After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed the body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. continue our reflection on the cross of Christ as we remember Jesus' final words. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. Woman, here is your son. To the disciple, he said, here is your mother. My God, why have you forsaken me? I'm thirsty. Father, into your hands I come.